Thank you. That concludes topical questions. The next item of business is a statement by Neil Gray on Ferguson Marine. The Cabinet Secretary will take questions at the end of his statement, and so there should be no interventions or interruptions. And I call on Neil Gray, up to 10 minutes, Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Today's statement maintains once again this Government's commitment to update Parliament on the progress in the building of two new ferries, MV Glensannox 801 and MV Glenrosa 802, at the Ferguson Marine Shipyard in Port Glasgow. It also gives me an opportunity to reassure Parliament that we remain committed to doing all we can to ensure a sustainable future for the yard and are working with them to find a way forward that will maintain shipbuilding and all the benefits this provides to the community in and around Inverclyde. Glensannox and Glenrosa will provide lifeline connectivity for the community on Arran, ensuring access to healthcare and education services, supporting day-to-day commercial activity and providing a boost to the tourism industry, which contributes so much to the island's economy. The delivery of these ferries matters, and I welcome the scrutiny provided by this Parliament, and in particular by the Net Zero Energy and Transport and the Public Audit Committees. This scrutiny is right and proper, and I want to take this opportunity to reiterate my commitment to being as open and transparent as possible as their work progresses and concludes. In this regard, I note that the Public Audit Committee wrote to me recently requesting further information on a number of matters, and I can give an assurance that this will be provided in a timely manner wherever it is commercially appropriate to do so. Firstly, therefore, let me provide an update on the delivery of the two vessels. In doing so, I will address issues that have been raised in relation to the certification of the vessels and provide an update on the pathway to their handover to CalMAC. In his update to the Net Zero Energy and Transport Committee at the end of September, the Chief Executive of Ferguson Marine indicated that the delivery of the vessels had been complicated by issues related to the certification by the Maritime and Coast Guard Agency, and as a result, the estimated cost to deliver both vessels had increased. The Maritime and Coast Guard Agency is a UK-wide regulator that plays a vital important role in providing certification to ships and seafarers. They are engaged very early in the delivery of new vessels, particularly those of a first-in-class design, such as the MV Glensannox. This is consistent with shipbuilding practice across the world and allows for both refinement and development of designs in response to certifier input. The MCA engagement involves both its Scotland office in Glasgow and UK office in Southampton, and we understand that the process of engagement between the MCA and Ferguson Marine Engineering Limited around Glensannox and Glenrosa began back in 2015, with the formal approval process commencing in 2016. I understand from talking to the management at Ferguson's that they enjoy good relationships with the organisation as a whole and have worked well together in addressing concerns that had arisen about the original designs. As reported by the Chief Executive of Ferguson Marine, a number of modifications have been made to the original design in the last few months in order to secure final MCA approval, including the provision of additional stairways from the upper decks of the ships. These changes have been made successfully, and whilst there have, as reported by the Chief Executive, been delays and increases to his original cost estimates as a result, it was the right thing to do to make sure these changes on Glensannox and the modified designs will be adopted on Glenrosa. More recent design issues involving below-deck escape trunks were being considered by the MCA, and I'm pleased to note today the CEO has informed both myself and the Net Zero Energy and Transport Committee that this process has been completed with approval of these design modifications. This means that the vessel will move to phase one of the dockside trials before her move to dry dock for the next phase of work on the 18th of December. Final outfitting will continue when she returns to Quayside after this and before sea trials that are planned for January. There is further positive news from the Chief Executive on MV Glenrosa, who recently announced that the planned slipway launch and naming ceremony has been set for the 12th of March 2024, and I look forward to being kept appraised of this planned milestone. As I said earlier, however, these changes have consequences, and it was with much regret and incredible disappointment that I noted the most recent update from the Chief Executive, which set out delays to his projections of the delivery dates and an increase of estimated costs around the build of both vessels. His letter puts the total cost of delivering Glensannex at £130 million since the point of public ownership and £100 million for Glenrosa. This represents an increase of £32 million for Glensannex and £4.8 million for Glenrosa from the cost estimates provided in September 2022. Of this, he reported that uncommitted spend at the end of September was £10 million for Glensannex and £45 million for Glenrosa, and he made provision of up to an additional £30 million to cover contingency issues that may arise, particularly during the sea trials that need to take place before final handover to CalMAC. He projected the delivery dates as being 31st March 2024 for Glensannex and 31st May 2025 for Glenrosa. We're currently working with the Yard and our external advisers to scrutinise these costs and do all we can to assist Ferguson Marine in minimising contingency cost and delays, as you would expect, Presiding Officer. And I will update the Public Audit Committee on the timeline for this work as soon as possible. But I do think it is worth saying that on the basis of the information that we have before us from the Chief Executive, we remain committed to the delivery of both vessels by Ferguson Marine, and that the conclusions that are reached in issuing a written authority earlier this year continue building Glenrosa at the Yard with all the benefits that this will bring to the workforce and the community that remain valid. We will, of course, continue to monitor and scrutinise the costs and progress associated with the delivery of Glensannex and Glenrosa as part of our due diligence exercise. There is no doubt in my mind that to consider a re-procurement would be highly detrimental to the island communities we serve, because it would likely push the delivery date for Glenrosa back to 2028. And I do not believe that anyone in this Parliament would want me to do that, and I'm not prepared to let our communities down in that way. So before I move on, I'm also conscious that the Public Audit Committee have asked me to consider what, if any, information from the previous due diligence reports carried out on the forecast costs provided in September 22 could now be made available. I'm looking at whether the passage of time has reduced the commercial sensitivity of these reports, and will respond to the committee formally by the required date. But some of the content of these reports does remain the intellectual property of the commercial advisers, and in reaching a decision I must always be guided by the need to ensure that we do not harm the ability of the shipyard to compete for and secure future work. So let me now move on to the future of the Yard. In considering the next steps for FMPG after delivery of Glenrosa, we have been very clear that our priorities are to preserve the skilled jobs and secure a sustainable future for the shipyard. Earlier this year, we received a business plan and accompanying request for investment from the Yard, and we are currently working with them to refine those plans and try to put together a proposal that will provide the kind of future we all want to see. Any such request must meet subsidy control rules, as I have set out previously, and needs to demonstrate value for money and be open to parliamentary scrutiny. Our independent due diligence on the initial capital request concluded with the initial business case would not meet the commercial market operator test, a key legal requirement if we are to demonstrate compliance with the subsidy control regime, and therefore we continue to examine options that would be compliant. At the same time, the markets in which Ferguson Marine operate continue to change, and indeed a key component of the initial case for investment was contingent on a specific type of work winning a specific pipeline of work that FMPG board and management have recently concluded should not be pursued at this time. Both the Yard and ourselves recognise that it is vital that any investments support a business plan that reflects evolving circumstances, is genuinely deliverable and meets our legal requirements and subsidy control. So we will leave no stone unturned in finding a way forward, and will consider all options for securing a future based on a promising order book. This will be done at pace, and I expect to report back on progress as soon as possible. I understand that this may be unsettling for the workforce, but it is important that we get this right, and I hope that I am leaving no one in any doubt about this government's commitment to retaining shipbuilding on the Clyde and providing future opportunities for the new and indeed future workforce in the local community. Presiding Officer, I am committed to ensuring that these vessels are delivered as soon as possible to our island communities. I'm also committed to doing all we can to support the shipyard to secure a route to a sustainable future, and to do so we have committed to provide assistance to the Chief Executive in the development of a revised business case for capital investment. The two ferries, of which one of which is nearing completion at over 84% cost to complete, will support the Clyde Coast communities for future generations. They will increase capacity and provide a boost for the island economy, which will have benefits in ensuring a vibrant future for businesses located there. The yard itself also remains of vital significance to the local, regional and national economy of Scotland, and the progress I have outlined today delivers on those commitments.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. The Cabinet Secretary will now take questions on the issues raised in his statement. I intend to allow around 20 minutes for questions, after which we will move on to the next item of business. It would be helpful if those members who would wish to seek to ask a question were to press the request to speak buttons now. And I call Graeme Simpson.
Thank you very much. And can I thank the Cabinet Secretary for advance sight of his statement? Many would have been hoping for some good news about the future of the yard today. Workers will be watching this and feeling a sense of despair. A cross-party group of MSPs wrote to the Cabinet Secretary on September the 7th, saying that investment in a new plating line was essential if the yard is to become competitive. And David Tideman asked for tens of millions of pounds for that. Perhaps the Cabinet Secretary can say what the exact figure is, and he's been clear that a decision is time critical. Today, the Cabinet Secretary is saying that he cannot proceed. He talks about securing a future based on a promising order book. There will be no such order book without that investment. Presiding Officer, the Cabinet Secretary talks about needing to see a revised business plan. Can he tell us what is lacking from the one that's before him? And can he say if he genuinely thinks the yard has a future without without the further time-critical investment that's been asked for, because it certainly doesn't feel that way?
Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you very much indeed, and I thank Graeme Simpson for his questions. Graeme Simpson asked me for good news. I think there is good news within that statement around the declaration from the MCA this morning, allowing Glensanex and Glenrosa to be able to proceed. I think that is good news. And also the fact that the Chief Executive has come forward with the launch date for Glenrosa. This demonstrates the progress that has been made by the yard, by the workforce, in delivering upon the commitments that our island communities need from these vessels. In terms of the funding request, I set out in my statement the issues that there were around the initial business case. However, the request for funding is still undergoing development. So any investment provided to Ferguson Marine has to comply with regulatory propriety and value for money assessments, as well as subsidy control legislation. And we'll continue to work with the yard on having that finalised application coming forward, because it's not clear, it's not definitive as yet.
I call Casey Clark.
The people of Inverclyde and Scotland want a competitive shipbuilding industry. International benchmarking agents have made recommendations, and cross-party and cross-sector representations have been made for infrastructure investment in the yard. There has already been a catalogue of mistakes by management and the Scottish Government relating to Ferguson Marine. Does the Scottish Government not accept there can be no further delay, and they cannot stand back and sabotage the shipyard by preventing them to compete competitively?
Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you very much. I agree with Katie Clark that we want to see competitive commercial shipbuilding on the Clyde. We agree upon that, which is why we are doing all that we can to support the yard, both in the delivery of these vessels, which is critically important for island communities and the workforce and the reputation of the yard, but also in supporting them and coming forward with that business plan around what the investment in the yard is actually going to look like and what it's prioritised towards. Because, as I say, the market has moved. The investments that the yard would want to see in order to get access to contracts has changed, and so we'll continue to support the yard as they come forward with that revised business case.
I call Ivan McKee to be followed by Douglas Lumsden. Mr McKee.
I welcome the update from the Cabinet Secretary on the progress that's been made. with the work taking place at Ferguson's, and a recognition from him of the importance of securing a long-term future for the yard and the sector in Scotland. So can I ask what work has the Scottish Government done to seek out industrial partners to bring investment, technology and expertise to help secure the long-term future of the yard?
Cabinet Secretary.
I thank Ivan McKee for that question. As I've set out, my officials have worked closely with the Board and the Chief Executive to identify possible areas for investment and upgrade. And shipbuilding is a highly specialised industrial area, and so we have to also contracted with specialist advisers to assist in identifying a path to a sustainable future, and this work is ongoing. As part of our work to support the yard and develop a revised business plan for the request for CapEx, we are considering all options, including potential partnerships opportunities, and obviously that while that work is ongoing, we will do what we can to ensure that that is made public as soon as considerations have concluded.
I call Douglas Lumsden to be followed by Kate Forbes.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I ask the Cabinet Secretary how much was requested by Ferguson Marine for a new plating line?
Cabinet Secretary.
The business case and the request for investment, capital investment in the yard, has been set out previously in the correspondence and the discussions that I've had with committee. We're now in the situation where this has been revised.
Cabinet Secretary, please resume your seat. So a question has been asked of the Cabinet Secretary, and the person who has the floor should be able to provide the answer that they provide without any sedentary chuntering. Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. I've set out very clearly that the application for capital investment is changing, and so the investment that is needed at the yard is going to be, we're going to be supporting the yard in coming forward with that business case to do what we can to ensure that whatever capital investment is required to help make the yard competitive, we do what we can within the subsidy control legislation to ensure that we are complying with that and doing what we can to ensure that the yard remains competitive.
I call Kate Forbes to be followed by Paul Sweeney. Ms Forbes.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I start by paying tribute to the workers who found themselves often at the mercy of ever-changing leadership, ownership and political rhetoric. The only way to sustain the future for the yard is to ensure it can compete for contracts on merit. Can the CabSec advise on whether the yard is indeed becoming more competitive and how we complete that journey?
Cabinet Secretary.
Yes. I mean, first of all, in response to Kate Forbes' initial point, I absolutely and wholeheartedly agree, and I enjoy very positive working relationship with the shop stewards who represent the workers at the yard, and pay tribute to the work of the workers that are at the yard and the shop stewards, the unions who have been representing them, for the very reasons that Kate Forbes set out. Officials are working with the yard to develop and refine the business case to ensure that the yard can continue to be competitive. Any investment provided to Ferguson Marine has to comply with regulatory irregularity, propriety and value for money assessments, as well as subsidy control legislation. Failure to do so would leave any award of investment open to legal challenge. However, my team, myself, the yard, we're working together to do everything we can to make sure that the yard can be competitive for future work, and look and make sure that we're targeting those areas where that might be possible.
I call Paul Sweeney to be followed by Stuart McMillan. Mr Sweeney.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. The Minister has said that he must be guided by the need to ensure that we don't harm the ability of the shipyard to compete for and secure future work. On that, we are certainly agreed. And it is also agreed, as verified by consultants, that the shipyard does need capital investment to be competitive, particularly in a new panel line supplied by Pemimec of Finland. Other shipyards in the UK are investing in such technologies, such as Harland & Wolff in Belfast, and it also fits very well with the National Shipbuilding Strategy refresh by the UK Government. So will the Scottish Government consider creating a programme of investment, perhaps through the Scottish National Investment Bank and Scottish Enterprise, which is available to all shipbuilding activity in Scotland, regardless of the ownership, and will allow for these capital investments to be made to achieve the national strategic objective of growing a shipbuilding industry? That would get round the restrictions the Cabinet Secretary has identified around commercial market operator test. Will he consider that measure?
Cabinet Secretary.
We're considering all avenues where we can support the yard and also the maintenance of commercial shipbuilding on the Clyde. It's the whole reason why we stepped in and public ownership was brought forward, so that we could do everything that we could with the powers that we had and the resources that we had available in order to make sure that we delivered these ferries and that we maintained as best as we possibly could a future for commercial shipbuilding. So, of course, we will consider all potential options to see the investment in the yard to make sure it can maintain competitiveness.
I call Stuart McMillan to be followed by Alec Cole-Hamilton.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Cabinet Secretary stated that the Scottish Government remains committed to doing all it can to ensure a sustainable future for the yard. On the 12th of March in 2024, when the Glenrosa is launched, the building of new ships becomes even more essential. When will the Scottish Government announce an update regarding the small vessel programme, and will a decision be made on the direct award with or without any new investment, which would actually safeguard the future of the yard and also the jobs in my community?
Cabinet Secretary.
I thank Stuart McMillan for his question and his ongoing stout advocacy for his constituents, the workforce and the yard in his constituency. We will consider future vessel contracts from public agencies on a case-by-case basis and whether it might be legally possible and appropriate to use direct awards. Direct award is only possible in limited circumstances under procurement rules, and breaching those rules could lead to legal challenge, costing the taxpayer and causing delay. But we will give all of these options serious consideration going forward.
I call Alec Cole-Hamilton, to be followed by Kenneth Gibson.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. Presiding Officer, Parliament will be forgiven for not celebrating the Glen Rose's launch date, because Nicola Sturgeon's pretend christening of the Glen Sannox 6 years ago came with painted-on windows, fake engines and the wrong bow. It was enough to make Kim Jong-un blush. And still, our island communities suffer. Dave Tideman, the CEO of Ferguson Marine, believes the boats will be worth just £70 million apiece when they are finally finished. That's a fraction of the £360 million that taxpayers' money spent on their construction. So will the Minister confirm that that is also the Government's assessment of the ferry's market value? And will he tell the Chamber why no SNP Minister has ever resigned over a scandal that can be seen from space?
Cabinet Secretary.
Alec Cole-Hamilton misunderstands the process by which shipbuilding happens. A launch date is the first opportunity that the ships reach the water for the next stage of their build. And so this is the next stage for Glenrosa going forward. It's the normal part of the process in order to see progress be made on the building works. In terms of the value of the vessels coming forward, obviously this is going to be part of the work being done to assess the value going forward and how they are reported in the accounts, and that will all be publicly available upon its completion.
I call Kenneth Gibson to be followed by Maggie Chapman. Mr. Gibson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Given recent cancellations on the Brodick ferry route due to both the weather and technical problems, what discussions has the Cabinet Secretary had with Ferguson Marine about the increased reliability and resilience the Glen Sannox and Glenrosa will deliver when they enter service on the route itself? And when is that expected to be? Because that is the question that islanders are asking.
Cabinet Secretary.
Once again, thank Kenny Gibson for his question. This has a material impact on the constituents that he represents and does so doubtfully in this chamber. The new vessels and the related work, port works, have been designed to improve capacity, reliability and resilience on the Arran route. Port works at Brodick are complete, temporary works at Troon are nearing completion, and work is continuing on the review of the business case and the costs for our Drossen upgrades. As set out in the latest update from the yard to the NZ committee, MV Glen Sannox is due to be delivered by the yard by the 31st of March 2024, with deployment on the Arran route expected in summer, subject to the completion of the build and successful sea trials. The final date for entry into service is for Calmac. However, everything that we and Ferguson's are working towards is for Sannox to be operational on the summer timetable.
I call Maggie Chapman to be followed by Edward Mountain.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. We know that ferries are a vital are vital for island communities and their economies. We also know that many services require upgrading or replacing. Does the Cabinet Secretary agree that we need a long-term strategy for ferry procurement, manufacture, maintenance and replacement, learning the lessons from Ferguson Marine? We need community engagement, secure jobs, the decarbonisation of fleets and a rolling programme of build and refurb for all of our island communities. Can the Cabinet Secretary say whether he agrees with this, and if so, whether this will form part of the forthcoming Green Industrial Strategy?
Cabinet Secretary.
I thank Maggie Chapman for that question. I set out in my answer to previous questions around the issue of direct award and indeed around procurement of vessels. Obviously, we need to work with the procuring authorities in that regard and also make sure that decisions are proportionate, subject to the subsidy control elements that I've already set out. And obviously, we will do everything that we can to make sure that there is that certainty for island communities going forward. And I'm happy in the regular meetings and updates that I have with Green colleagues to set out that in more detail.
I call Edward Mountain, followed by Evelyn Tweed. Mr. Mountain.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. Today, the audit of the annual accounts was published, which said that it was clearly uncertain whether the yard could continue as a going concern. It also said that bonuses had been paid without approval of the Scottish Government. Now, the Board, according to the Cabinet Secretary, doesn't believe that the business case is based on work that they can possibly win. So they've asked for £40 million, I think is the figure, Cabinet Secretary, you're looking for, to do something they don't believe is any worth investing in. So what will the business case be based on, and what will the amount of money that is needed to keep this vital yard in operation?
Cabinet Secretary.
I thank Edward Mountain, the Chair of the Committee, for his question. As I set out in my statement, I also thank him and his committee for the work that they do to scrutinise this and to ensure ministers, also Ferguson's, are held accountable on delivering these vital ferries for the island communities that need them so badly. As I've set out already, the business case is now subject to change. We're working with Ferguson's and supporting them on that to ensure that it is responsive to the changing market conditions and the areas of work that the yard are looking to attempt to win. And we'll continue to do so because we are committed to ensuring, as far as we possibly can, that there is a sustainable commercial shipbuilding operation on the Clyde.
And I call Evelyn Tweed.
It is clear that inflationary and other significant pressures could increase the cost to complete these vessels. Can the Cabinet Secretary outline ongoing control and scrutiny to ensure that remaining costs are tightly controlled?
Cabinet Secretary.
Yes, I can, because this is critically important. Ferguson Marine are required to submit monthly financial reports to the sponsor directorate within government, and these are scrutinised by our technical advisers, CMAL, and by our finance teams to ensure that they are necessary and representative of good value.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. That concludes the ministerial statement, and there will be a short pause before we move on to the next item of business to allow front bench teams to change position should they so wish. Thank you.